Hello, I'm Wallace Ford, and welcome to the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition. Remember, the Inclusion Show is the only show that includes you. And we're going to try something different on the show today. We're calling it in-person dialogue. We're having a conversation with a guest co-host, Ms. Monique John. Monique, welcome to the Inclusion Show.
Thank you.
Weekend Edition.
I'm glad to
be
here.
Okay, great. So what we've talked about, and we're going to see how this works out, I'm sure it'll be fun, is we're going to have a conversation here and just talk about some of the current active events, things that are going on in this world of ours, and just kind of see where we come out on these things. But for starters, I do want to introduce you to the audience. Monique, you are from New York. I know that much. But why don't you tell the audience a little bit about yourself, please?
Yes, I'm from New York. I went to school at Fordham University, and I currently work as a writer. So you would see my work at hellobeautiful.com, where I currently serve as a blogger, as well as The Root for Harriet and the Feminist Wire, as well as my personal blogs. And I tend to focus my writing on current affairs, of course, but specifically through lenses of racial politics and feminist politics.
Okay, well, that sounds like a good setup for some of the things we're going to be talking about here today. I mean, you know, the news is full these days with respect to the law enforcement system, criminal justice. We've had recent grand jury decisions not to indict policemen involved in lethal encounters with black males in Ferguson, Missouri, and in Staten Island, New York. There are other stories, unfortunately, that are out there as well. But when you heard the news that the grand jury has decided not to indict Officer Darren Wilson for the shooting of Michael Brown, what was your first reaction on all this, Monique?
My first reaction, I guess my body physically reacted with just this immense pain, literally, because I, like so many people in our country, were waiting and waiting to hear this announcement. After hearing other stories of young men similar to Mike Brown, you know, with stories like Jordan Davis and Trayvon Martin and Oscar Grant and Amadou Diallo and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, I guess this time I foolishly and naively hoped that we would get an indictment, get something to move forward with the case, especially after my...
So you were surprised?
I was. Okay, I really was, a little surprised.
Because you were mentioning, like, you know, in the Trayvon Martin case, George Zimmerman was indicted.
Right.
You know, of course, he wasn't convicted.
Right.
You know, and like in Rodney King, the police were indicted, but they weren't convicted, not on state charges, ultimately on federal charges.
Right. And it just felt like weird. We took a major step backwards with this case and with Eric Garner's
case. I was going to say, now then we have the case of Eric Garner in Staten Island with officer, New York City Police Department, NYPD officer Pantaleo, who seen on the video that's been seen by literally millions of people all over the world. Mm-hmm. And if that's not a chokehold there, then I guess we just don't know what a chokehold is.
Right.
But yet, the grand jury decided not to indict him on anything, not a single charge.
Yeah.
And so, okay, we've got Ferguson, and just as we're trying to digest that news, bang, we've got Staten Island. Okay?
And
what was your reaction when
I mean, with Pantaleo, that really took me off guard. Because in truth, to be perfectly honest with you, I didn't know that they would be making the announcement about, you know, the fact that they weren't going to indict him this week. And I was still in the throes of the whole Ferguson situation. I know people are still organizing protests and stuff. Now, of course, there are more protests because of Eric Garner. But this time around, I almost couldn't even bring myself to go out into the streets and to march, because at that point of this week, it just felt like, what is it really for?
I was gonna get to that, because, you know, I teach at Medgar's College, and so we've got 7,000 students there, and you know, many of them are young people, and like yourself, and they're saying, okay, we want to march, we want to have a rally, we want to protest, we want to do something, okay. But as you're saying, the question is, towards what end, towards
exactly.
what purpose? This is not like when I was a teenager and we were marching and protesting. They have civil rights bills passed to outlaw segregation. They will let people go to a hotel, you know, something as simple as a hotel or a restaurant, or be able to vote, much more importantly. These are kind of tangible goals.
Whereas now we're dealing with microaggressions. It's a lot more about our interactions with people and how they're coded in certain ways that aren't always explicitly translated in the bill, which I guess is part of the reason why it's so hard to tackle this issue at this point. And it's funny because as far as the first protests that were set off, like particularly last Monday, or I don't remember exactly which date it was, but essentially the evening in which it was announced that Darren Wilson wouldn't be indicted, I remember I came home immediately after work and I sat in front of my laptop for hours waiting for the announcement. And I was by myself. And once I finally heard the announcement, I thought, I want to go out to the streets now just for the sake of being with other people, just to have that connection with other people and to be able to mourn with other people. Not even in the belief that President Obama will magically come up with some new policy that will end, you know, police brutality forever and ever and ever.
But you know, there's something about, you know, you're absolutely right. I think we agree about, you know, President Obama, what he can and cannot do. But think about this for a minute, because we do have the Department of Justice conducting civil rights investigations, both with the Ferguson non-indictment and now the Staten Island non-indictment.
Right.
And do you think that the Attorney General appointed by President Mitt Romney would be doing this? Probably not.
Probably not.
Probably not. And
probably
and so
not.
There is a difference. Mm-hmm. There is a difference. You know, for all the beating up that people do on Barack Obama, all, you know, from time to time, there certainly is that. Now, here's something. We're going to take a quick break, Monique. We're going to call you Mo. You know, we're going to take a quick break. But when we come back, let's talk about the other side of the coin with respect to these cases that we're talking about, because these has been raised as well, that we see the protests with respect to Pantaleo or Wilson killing, but what happens when a black person kills a black person, and what should we be doing about that? This is the Inclusion Show, Weekend Edition. We will be right back. Welcome back to the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition. Our co-host is Ms. Monique John, Mo, to her friends, and I guess now here on the show. We're talking really about some serious topics, though, here in terms of the reaction to the recent non-indictments in Ferguson and in Staten Island, and the list, unfortunately, is too long to recount here on this show. But a number of people have commented on the fact, and I know I have myself on this show, over the fact that we don't see, Mo, the same outrage amongst people of color when people of color kill other people of color, and the overwhelming statistics, as horrific as these Ferguson and Staten Island instances might be, the daily death toll of people of color killing people of color is something that doesn't seem to elicit that same outrage, communal mourning, call for action. What's your take on that?
I think that's an undeniable fact. And I also think that the reason why that happens is probably because of the narrative that we're all so used to talking about, like the way we talk about racial issues and the way we call together as a community to react to them. I guess it's, I mean, I kind of have my concern in terms of flipping the conversation that way, because I also have seen how, like, Rudy Giuliani's comments, he made a very similar argument. And I guess my concern is that I can see how conservatives use that to kind of take away from the seriousness of
what...
Well,
see, but it's not an either-or proposition, mm-hmm. and that's what somebody like a thug like Rudy mm-hmm. Giuliani, and I apologize to the thugs in the audience, we'll try to make that kind of either-or proposition, and mm-hmm. it's not either-or. I think mm-hmm. you can be outraged by the police,
right.
And you can be outraged by the gangsters and gangbangers mm-hmm. and thugs in black and Latino communities mm-hmm. preying on our own people.
Mm-hmm.
We can walk and chew gum at the same time, can't
mm-hmm.
we?
You know, we can. So, I think that it really calls for, I guess, us as a community being really honest with ourselves in terms of educating ourselves on how patriarchy and violence works and how that affects us as a people, but also how we then can find ourselves contributing to those institutions,
okay.
to those oppressions onto one another.
Well said, Mo. Well said. Let's switch channels for a moment here. Talk about something different. I don't say lighter, but different. There's a Republican operative recently who just decided that she obviously didn't have anything better to do than to criticize the president's daughters, Sasha and Malia, for their not seem particularly enthused about a Thanksgiving announcement, although why teenagers would be particularly enthused about something like that. No teenagers impressed by their father, I don't care who he is. And
yeah.
As a father of a teenager, I can tell you mm-hmm. that's true. And also their dress. And so they look like they should be trying to find a place at the bar, which is just...
It's her words.
Yeah. So but here's what I'd like to throw out here for you to respond to, though, Monique, which is that the level and types of insults that have been leveled at President Obama and Michelle Obama and Michelle Obama's mother and now the children are different, it seems to me. It feels different somehow. Mm-hmm. I mean, everybody's fair game if you're in the White House, but doesn't this feel different somehow?
I felt like, this was very different because, I mean, I don't... Are you saying normally everyone is fair game except for the daughters? Because I always thought that the tradition is that the children especially are off limits.
You make a very good point. No,
we've seen that in previous years with previous presidents.
When Bill Clinton was president, if you said a word about Chelsea, mm-hmm. you'd literally, you'd be in the cone of silence as a reporter
right.
Or commentator forever. You just weren't going to be allowed to cover that kind mm-hmm. of activity. And when President Bush's daughters were being arrested for alcohol-related charges and what have you, the charge might be published one day. That was it. It was mm-hmm. a one-day story.
Right.
But to say that a 13-year-old looks like she's dressed for going to a bar, which is one step from saying that, I don't know, she's in some kind of, hooker whoredom kind of world or something like this, it just seems to be so inappropriate.
I completely agree. I felt it was interesting because, for one, it directly spoke to how people immediately feel this comfort with attaching codes of deviance for Black people, especially Black people in very, very public and visible spaces, very public roles. But I also guess this episode speaks to the fact that the Obama girls are occupying a very unique time period in terms of how the media operates, how quickly these stories run, and how everyone can say anything, and it can still be seen and talked about by large audiences in a way that Chelsea's era wasn't.
But don't you think it's also a matter, even though they're 13 and 16, they fall into this category, unfortunate category, of being fair game for what people can say about Black women.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's one thing to say they look like they were dressed informally and mm-hmm. but saying that a 13-year-old looked like she's trying to find a place at the bar, I mean, that's not even code, all right? I mean, that's mm-hmm. that's pretty direct language. It's saying like she's looking at a pickup, a cheap date. I don't know but how do you say this about these young girls? Except for where's the license to do that? Except mm-hmm. for the fact that they're not just young girls; they're young Black girls.
I think that it already comes along with the fact that Black womanhood, but especially Black girlhood, occupies a very, very unique, kind of similar to the media space in terms of media space, but also in terms of Black girlhood. There's this similar sort of disregard for that age, for that ability for young Black people to just be kids
and to leave it at that. Yeah.
And to not have to attach all these other meanings towards it. It's kind of how I know people have kind of written about this and mused about this, about how as simple as a situation as a group of Black girls on the subway. So you'll walk into a train one afternoon, you'll see a little group of Black girls like talking and laughing and just being kids on the subway, maybe around the pole, just being kids in the middle of this space. And you see people around them on the train getting a little uncomfortable maybe kind of turning into themselves, maybe visibly being annoyed by the noise that they're making. Whereas with white children, that's not always
They're just being kids. We're going to take another break here, Amo. This is the Inclusion Show, Weekend Edition, and we will be right back. Welcome back to the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition. I am your host, Wallace Ford, our co-host and guest, Monique John, and we've been having an interesting conversation here so far on a range of topics. In the time we have left, I've got to talk about Bill Cosby. All right, this is you know, Bill Cosby, America's iconic, everybody loves Bill Cosby. Mm-hmm. Now is just, you know, his reputation seems to be in shambles with all of the attacks and accusations made against him. He stepped down as a member of the board of trustees at Temple. He lost Temple University. The U.S. Navy revoked his honorary yeoman title, and the list kind of goes on in terms of all of this. As you have seen this unfold, what's your take on it?
So a lot of people have been asking me, do I believe he did it? Do I not believe that he did it? I don't actually have any evidence in front of me aside from the victim's testimonies or alleged victim's testimonies. So I can't say for sure what actually happened. But I do have to say that in terms of the way other people have been reacting to this, in terms of like the institutions, as far as Temple, as far as
the Navy.
But also in terms of like the television networks and how they've been seriously pulling back like thousands, millions of dollars and all these really prestigious titles in the name of this situation. That I find really interesting and really, that I guess is a step forward, because at least it shows us that finally people are taking these allegations, these kinds of stories seriously when it comes to rape.
Well, there's no doubt that rape and sexual violence, you know, they have to be taken more seriously than they have been in this society. We see a huge problem in colleges and universities right now, and I think why it's such a huge problem is people are talking about it more than they did perhaps 10, 15, 20 years ago. And so there's no question about it. But here's the thing: is that what we have are accusations. Okay, and whatever you may think of them, or I may think about them in terms of their credibility, that's what they are. There's nobody's proven anything, and there's all kinds of mechanisms, and we call them the courts, to prove these things, and that just hasn't happened. If Bill Cosby is engaged in the kind of behavior that's been alleged, I'm going to be the last person in the world to defend it, say, oh, there's some reason or rationale for doing it. So let me be clear on that. But
there's no justifying it if it did happen.
Yeah.
But we don't know.
But these are accusations. Mm-hmm. And so what, so if you don't get a day in court, or if the only court is the court of public opinion, and it means that even somebody as iconic as Bill Cosby can be brought low, what does that mean for everybody else that's out there?
As far as the other people who find themselves in that similar situation.
Situation being unjustly accused.
If you're unjustly accused. Yeah. And I mean, that's...
Yeah, you could wind up like Bill Cosby. Here's Bill Cosby, who's got 40 years of iconic stature in American culture, for goodness sake,
right,
and a series of accusations, mm-hmm, which, again, just haven't been proved. There are a series of accusations.
Once you reach that point where, first of all, there's enough people behind you on this that actually feel fired up enough to actually go behind it, for one, I feel like that's credibility in its own right. But two, I mean, if it's already gotten to that point, there's nothing anybody can do,
but
right? I mean, it's almost like,
but doesn't he
too Bill, bad for Bill Cosby and I, like you
well,
know
but doesn't Bill Cosby or anybody else deserve to at least if you're going to be, because anybody can accuse anybody of anything, okay, and the more horrific it is, the more attention it's going to get.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but that doesn't make it true. It just
Nobody's saying it. Nobody doesn't say it's true.
It's say the accusations are enough. Just the sheer accusation. Right. But we were talking about this off camera. You find it where you've got particularly audacious prosecutors who will face with child abuse cases and sexual molestation of young children can be coached into saying things that will make the accused, the defendant, look like horrible people.
I'm fully aware of what prosecutors can do to sway the public and to sway alleged victims into storytelling.
We don't have a single prosecutor.
We don't. But I will be more sympathetic towards Bill Cosby when he makes a serious, direct comment on this because hiding behind his lawyer doesn't impress
but
me.
That ridiculous conversation
he had with the AP on camera with his wife, Camille. Yeah, like it just.
But what? But it so didn't, he's, he so didn't. He's, so he gets on camera and says, I didn't do it. That's not going to satisfy anybody.
It's not going to satisfy anybody.
Anybody.
But at the end of the day, until he comes out from behind the skirt of his wife
and just takes the beating,
addresses it,
and says,
"There's nothing anybody can do.
I didn't do it. I don't know what these women are talking about. It's unfortunate that they're saying these
people." And people might turn away from him even more. But at least if this is untrue, then at least he had the guts. At least he was man enough to stand up and say, "I did not do this."
I don't know. Well, I mean, again, is it one of these things, Monique, where no matter what he says.
Yeah.
No matter what he says.
Is it enough?
And my only concern is an accusation or a series of accusations. I mean, what's the, you know, is that enough to bring somebody down? So, you know, we're going to have to ask you to come back, okay? Because I really enjoyed having this conversation with you.
So did I.
And you certainly have an open invitation. We'll try this in-person dialogue again sooner than later, that's for sure. Monique John, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay, and now it's time for From the Heart, and the topic today is, what will I tell my son? I have a son, as you regular viewers know, is now 17 years old, is a young black man here in America. And after the non-indictments in Ferguson, Missouri, and in also in Staten Island, New York, I'm wondering, what am I supposed to tell my son about what the value is of the life of a young black man in this country, or not so young black man in this country? What faith should he have in the justice system? His mother and I, since he was a little boy, have told him and trained him about how to try to interact with law enforcement so that those encounters with law enforcement do not become lethal. But it appears that no matter what you do, there's still the possibility, the potential for that lethal encounter. And, so my son has grown up seeing the Trayvon Martin cases, and the list just goes on and on and on. Sean Bell in New York was in 2007, he's heard these stories, and he sees something less than justice being afforded when these incidents happen in the first place. And the question that I've got to ask myself is, what should I tell my son about how to carry himself as a young man, as an adult, what he should feel about law enforcement in this country, what he should feel about the system of justice in this country? What should I tell my son? This has been The Inclusion Show, Weekend Edition. I'm your host, Wallace Ford. Stay strong and be great.